One of the most noble things that we can be able to do in our lives is to raise other people, of course, raise children. And raise children not in a way that is uniform, so to speak, you know, uniform to one another. You know, asking kids, why can't you be like your brother? Why can't you be like your sister? Why can't you be like the other guy who was number one in class? The most important thing that we can be able to do in raising children is to raise them so that they can be purpose-driven. Raising purpose-driven children is a thing that we need to do. And I've been discussing that in this series, and I want to continue probably even as we're drawing close to the end of this series. I want to continue talking about one of the ways that we can be able to do this, even as we are experiencing a change, technological change, saturation of knowledge in this day and in this age. What will be the difference maker? Stay tuned.
Welcome to the Life Signatures Podcast with Lawrence Namale. Lawrence is a life coach, author, and keynote speaker who loves to tackle different topics on purpose, productivity, and resilience. His mission in life is to awaken all your boundless possibilities available in you. Life Signatures Podcast is dedicated to bring to reality every single person who knows that deep down in their gut, there's got to be more to life than this. And now, here is your host, Lawrence Namale.
Well, I think the first thing that we need to do is just to be conscious of the fact that there is a need to raise purpose-driven children in this day and in this age. That consciousness would drive our game, even if we did not know how, even if we did not know where we can be able to start and what tools we can be able to use to do this. Just the consciousness. They say that where there's a will, there's always going to be a way. Just the consciousness, the idea, the knowledge, the desire to do this creates the wherewithal, gives you the tools. All of a sudden you find someone who can teach you how to do it this. You can find tools and this and that and so on and so forth. So it is important for us to have the consciousness. And when you do have the consciousness, I'm going to maybe just do a recap. After you have the consciousness that I want to raise a purpose-driven child, the following things should be put in place. First of all, you need to be aware that you can teach them about the importance of money. Basically, the purpose of money in three ways. Money is for impact, money is for growth, and money is for rewards. That goes without saying. You've got to do that. Do that. And in so doing, you're gravitating them unconsciously towards thinking about purpose. Because left alone, money is for lust. What you can feed yourself with, what you can clothe yourself with, how you can show your pride and so on and so forth. That's what money will just take that form, that shape. But if you cultivate these two things of growth and impact, then it speaks to purpose. It speaks to other people because impact is for other people. Growth is for you and maybe even for other people, but impact is for other people. That's the first thing. The second thing that you've got to do, if you're to teach your children to live a life of purpose, the second thing that you've got to do is to make sure that you're asking them the why question at all times. When they say they want to do something and so on and so forth, you ask them the why question. Why do you want to do this? Why do you want to go there? Why do you think that music is the subject that you're going to take? Why do you think drumming is the subject that you want to take? And so on. The answer they give you is always going to be an answer of purpose. And even as they're looking for an answer, basically, they are looking for purpose. So cultivate the idea. Ask them the why. Let them not just do things because the neighbor is doing it, because it feels good and so on and so forth. But ask the why question. And number three, to follow with the why question, you also need to be able to answer that why question. They're going to be asking you very many questions. And one of the most important questions that a child can ask you is why. Don't brush them aside. Teach them. Give it a moment to think it through and teach them about purpose. Even if you might not be able to answer that question today, can you be able to do it another day? Can you be able to revisit that question and say, you asked me this and this and that, and now that you asked me that question, I've been reflecting, and this is the answer. So you give them the purpose related answer. In so doing, you're basically equipping this person, this child, to continue gravitating towards a life of purpose. The third thing, the fourth thing, is it the fourth or the fifth thing? It is the fourth thing, is to live out your purpose. Live it out large. In other words, these guys are going to see what you're passionate about and they will want to gravitate towards it. You don't need even to cram this thing into them. They will see the passion and they catch the vision. It's that easy. It's that simple. It's monkey see, monkey do. They are hero worshippers. They want to be like their heroes. And the first hero they should see at home is you, who is actually living out what you're passionate about and what your purpose is. And if they will ever ask you a question related to why are you doing what you're doing, then that's an opportunity for you to start talking about purpose, talking about uniqueness in our own selves, that we are different and we come with a difference on the face of the earth, and we're like messengers who have been sent to do stuff, to impact this world, to change things, to grow stuff and so on, to bring transformation and so on. And that's why you're passionate in doing whatever it is that you're passionate about. The fifth thing that you should answer when they ask you, you know, when you're leading, raising purpose-driven children, the fifth thing that we've said is that you live this thing together, work it out together. We talked about this yesterday. Learn to cultivate this purpose with them. Give them projects that are purpose-related, maybe in the community, things to do with the differences that you can make in the community, the problems that are available in the community, and how they can be able to solve those problems when they see someone poor, someone who doesn't have shoes, someone who doesn't go to school. It is possible for you to start making them to think that they can do something, because purpose is about impacting someone else. They can do something in the life of that person and make a difference in the life of that person in whatever small way that they can be able to do. And so you work together with them, either on their projects or on the project of the family or whatever it is. And in so doing, you're gravitating towards a life of purpose. But today I want us to talk about something extremely important, something very interesting. When it comes to raising purpose-driven children, you need to, number six, learn to cultivate their gifts and their talents. It goes without saying that if I create a three-legged stool, the idea that I'm putting the three legs on the stool is to give it capacity to hold someone who is sitting on the stool, or to hold an object that is sitting on the stool. The three legs of the stool correspond to the gifts and the talents that the child has. In other words, if a child is gifted in a particular way, then it follows that predominantly in life they should do stuff that are supported by their strengths, not trying to fit them in every weakness that they have. I'm sure it's important for us to explore and make them to be versatile. This is okay, it's given, you can be able to do that. However, what is the importance of the gift? Why should the gift be there? Why should the talent be there? Why should someone be born with music inside of them and don't use that ability and that talent? Why should someone be born with the ability to speak and we shut their mouth by giving them an accountancy job where they're going to hold themselves up in an office, in a cubicle, from 8 to 5 for the rest of their lives? It is unfair, to say the least. So the idea that there is a gift, a disposition, a predisposition, there is a talent, there is some kind of shape inside of them, it is an opportunity for us to start cultivating that gift and that talent by creating an environment through which they can be able to work and expand that gift and expand that talent. This is what parenting is all about, and that bit is a bit expensive, by the way. It is a bit expensive to explore the extent of the gift and the talents of a child. And I know I heard one person telling me that when they're going to do a degree in arts, it is much more expensive than the person who's doing a degree in education. I mean, I'm talking about fine art. And also maybe a degree in law is more expensive. A degree in engineering is more expensive. It varies. Sometimes when you're delving into the idea of vision, into the idea of the gift and the talent of someone, it is a bit expensive to do it. But that's what we are as parents. We're supposed to pay the price for their purpose to come to fruition. If you're interested, by the way, if you're interested in raising a purpose-driven child, as much as you're looking for them to be relevant in society, do not forget and do not neglect that the nucleus of their strength, that is their gift and their talent, can find relevance in society at one point in time. So let us not box ourselves in a way in which we're raising them so that they can be, this is the way and this is the highway. You're supposed to go to school, and in school you do mathematics, physics, chemistry. That's it. I mean, there's no other mode or format or method or style or appeal that you can be able to go to. Let us start incorporating their gifts and their talents. And I am seeing the education systems are changing over and over again. People talking about competency-based curriculums and so on and so forth, which is a good thing, because the competency-based curriculum should at least help us to activate and cultivate and create an environment that their interests, their gifts, their capacities, their abilities, their strengths, their talents can be able to be put into practice. And at the end of the day, we are not just cultivating the gift for the sake of cultivating the gift. We're cultivating the gift with a view of it finding relevance. Is this guy a writer? Why are you wasting time taking him to chemistry? Why don't you take him to a writing class, a writing school, and there are very many of them, and let him become a virtuoso in writing? And later on, if he wants to do chemistry, by all means, let him go and do chemistry. Don't neglect the gift that is inside of these people by steeping ourselves into a starter school that dictates that this is the way my dad did it, this is the way my granddad did it, this is the way I did it, and this is the way you are going to do it. No. Let us start really listening to the message that the divine has sent us by putting gifts and talents in the lives of people, and let us start cultivating those gifts and talents. Well, tomorrow we're going to probably come to a close of this series, but until then, I hope this makes sense to you. So, bye-bye.
Thank you for listening to Life Signatures Radio. If you enjoyed today's show, subscribe to Life Signatures Radio on iTunes, Stitcher, or visit our website at lifesignatures.libsyn.com. Life Signatures Radio, fresh, clean, and inspiring.